Next time, it's 3:02, so make sure I'll start at 3, okay? Because we have a lot of material to cover. I'm sorry. So it's full right now, and hopefully it will still it will stay this way, because when things get harder, students tend to stay at home, which I understand. I did it myself, so anyway, fortunately there's enough seats, but please all sit down. Do realize we're being recorded for national television. I actually don't know why, but so there is to show. If you ask a question, make sure that it comes across a little bit intelligent, okay? Doesn't really matter what you ask. So we will cover, this is a course, MATLAB, okay, MATLAB programming. And so, is this boring? Yes, it's very boring. But it's unfortunately necessary, okay? When you get older, a little bit older, you'll see that this is very useful. A lot of things that you're now doing, for instance, in Excel, you can do 10 times faster in MATLAB and with many more functionalities. So it's really important that you learn how to work with MATLAB. It's really useful, believe it or not. So the experience is that the first 5-6 weeks things might be difficult because suddenly you learn something completely new. But after 5 or 6 weeks, most students start to digest the material and they start getting better scores at the end. Typically last year, so don't get scared, last year I think we had 221 students and I think like 10 of them failed or so, okay? So don't run away yet, okay? Okay, so today's introduction, I already sent you the syllabus. So let's go over that first. And the syllabus here covers like, now I hope that you have the book. The scripts that I wrote, so for each lecture, not the first two because it's so basic, but all the other lectures, I wrote scripts and they summarize the book. And most students said, actually we do not need the book anymore, now we have the scripts. But you run the risk that I ask a question that's in the book and that I did not cover in class. I do not tend to do that, but if I feel the students are doing well, so the overall scores are very high, then I might do that. Because I don't want all students to get an A+, yeah? Even though that will give you great teaching evaluations, it needs to be somewhat more difficult, yeah? So, engineering problem solving, 4 credits, you have the book. My name is Jasper Vrugt, so I'm Dutch. Yeah, I'm from the Netherlands. I was born and raised in Amsterdam, the capital city. It's heaven for a lot of people here, yeah? So, I did a lot of things that you guys cannot do but still do. Okay. Okay, so that was my name. So yeah, I do have a Ph.D. I got my Ph.D. in Amsterdam. Then after I got my Ph.D., I spent 5 years at Los Alamos, the National Lab in New Mexico, where they built the atomic bomb. Yeah, I like heavy stuff. Yeah, I graduated and then I was like, you know, from small explosives to like really big bombs. Yeah, I thought that's nice material. Spent 5 years there, got a fellowship named after the lab director, Robert Oppenheim, so I got 5 years, I could do whatever I wanted to do, and after 5 years I decided I was in the middle of nowhere, and I was like, okay, you know, it's a little boring, yeah, in the middle of nowhere. Some people like that, isolation, yeah, but I didn't really like that, so then I finally ended up, I was like, okay, what the heck, let's go to California. I've been here before, I spent like 1/2 year, 2 years at UC Davis. Small campus, good for Dutch people because you can have a bike, yeah? And I had a friend, an Italian friend, who had the party hotline, yeah? So each night at 8:30 he would get a phone call and say, oh, the next party is at this and this address. You have to be ready at 10. So I got ready, we went 7 days a week, we went out. At the same time did some work. Still got my PhD somehow, I don't know how, but yeah. Then ended up at Los Alamos and now here and in Irvine. So this is the third time where I'm teaching this course. And so I have great help from two TAs. They're in the back. They're hiding. But that's Mojaban, Omid, and they will be helping you during your lab sessions, okay? And one of you, or at multiple of you, already had a session this morning, yeah? And that's a little, so just to be clear, that's a little inconvenient to have a session prior to the class, yeah? There's nothing, so in the evaluation, just make sure there's nothing I can do about this. I've mentioned it 57 times. Yeah, now it's actually recorded, so now I can send them a videotape. But there's nothing I can do about it. That's because you guys have all kind of other classes, and that's the only way it can be scheduled. So there's 5 lab sessions, and the lab session for which you are enrolled, those are the lab sessions in which you do your quiz and your test. That cannot change. Only in extreme circumstances. And why? Because otherwise, if everyone starts to change, we need to budget so much, it's just undoable. Okay? The tests for the different sessions and the quizzes are different. So the persons that take their quiz on Monday, the Wednesday people can talk to them, but the questions will be different, okay? Because otherwise, it's not so fair for the Monday students and the Wednesday students, because we also have the Friday students, yeah? So you cannot change, only under extreme circumstances, okay? That's one thing. So lab sessions by Mojaban Omid, and you know the time and date and where to show up. Now these are the lecture topics, okay, here from week 1 to week 9 and 10. And that will cover the entire book except some chapters. And we will not cover everything in this book, because I think the book is a little bit of an overkill at some places. There is a chapter, for instance, on interpolation. And the author, who is, I think he's German. He sounds very German, which is really sad by itself. But he's very German. Yeah. He decided to cover 55 ways to interpolate data. And I'm of the opinion that if you just know a few of them, that you will be able to figure out the rest. Yeah, we don't have to cover all 55. So it's not 55, but maybe 12 or so. So I will cover fewer topics than in the book. The quizzes and tests will generally cover what we covered in class. So if you're in class and you study the scripts well that I sent to you ahead of time, all the scripts are ready. And we either, so this is a question for you. I can send you all the scripts of the entire class, or I can send you the scripts just prior to the class. So it's up to you what you like. Okay, please don't send me an email, because then I'm going to get 200 emails with a yes or a no. I like getting emails because I don't have friends, so then you can email, you're like, okay, finally. Yeah. But think about that, because all the scripts are ready, everything is ready. It might be overwhelming if I send everything to you now. It might be more convenient to just send script by script. Or alternatively, Mojaban Omid, they can upload it to a website. We have a class website, okay, and I can circulate the address where we have uploaded the scripts for that week, that you can download them, including the homework solutions, because in each lab session you do homeworks. But we're not creating the homeworks, okay? We'll give you the homework solutions, and the TAs are there to help you if you need help, and they will go over problems jointly in class if people are stuck. Okay, so the outline here, week 1, we will cover chapter 1 and 2, okay? Introduction to MATLAB. So this is relatively easy the first week. Now week 2, we will cover chapters 3 and 4. Then week 3, we will cover chapters 6 and 7. So as you see, we will not do chapter 5. But that is chapter 5, that's not particularly useful at this stage. Then week 4 we'll go over chapter 7, week 5 chapter 8, and so forth. And in week 9 and 10 we will cover chapter 12. So there are no, I don't have office hours, okay? And that has worked well so far. That does not mean that I don't meet with students, but I don't have regular office hours. Based on what we do in class and the lab sessions, that should be sufficient. If it's not, contact the TA. They do a wonderful job. If that's not enough, you can write me an email and I will meet with you. Okay? And this has worked in the past, okay? So, now the grading is, we have a team project at the end. So in the last few weeks, I will assign a project for each team. And that will count for 10% of your final grade. Then lab participation, it's 15%. So each time you attend a lab, the TA will cross, will make clear on a piece of paper that you were there. If you miss more than two labs, you're not going to get your 15%. Okay? So this 15% is really easy. You just have to show up in lab and stay there for the time of the lab. Might be very difficult. Yeah, if there's like a soccer game going on or a basketball. I don't play basketball at 12 yet, yeah? But might be difficult, but this is an easy 15%, okay? The quizzes, we have three quizzes. Next week is the first quiz. And they all count for 5%. And then we have three exams, and they count for 20% each. Now, if you count that up, at least if I do, I get to 100%. Okay? Now, we now know what the lecture location is, and the SSPA 1100, and the lab location is MSTB 224. I assume that all of you know where that is, yeah? Collectively, no means yes, I guess. Okay. So, are things clear? So, it's a lot of material. It's like almost 800 pages. Don't get overwhelmed. Just study the scripts that we sent you. Starting from Friday, we will have scripts available because the first two lectures, the first lecture is more or less introduction, and the second lecture is still really easy. And then from there on, each lecture, we have a lecture script that I go over and that you have ahead of time that you can practice. Okay? Computer programming is just a matter of practice. Okay? Okay, you can look. So I can program here, and you can look at it, and you can think, oh, that's easy, I can do that myself. But that is not the way you learn computer programming. Computer programming is just a way of doing it yourself. That sounds really scary, but it's really a matter of just trying, doing it yourself. Okay? Like in the scripts that we provide, change some numbers, change something, see what happens, see if you understand that. If you are at that level, you'll get an A for this course for sure. The questions that we ask in the quizzes and the exams are directly related to what we do in class. Okay? So just practice. Do not think that you sit here and you look at me and you think, oh, I can do that, that's so easy. Don't think that you know how to program then, because I can predict that on a final or an exam or a quiz, whatever, that something goes wrong, you get an error warning and you don't know what to do anymore. Whereas if you practiced before and you get an error warning, then you know what to do based on the error warning. So it's just a matter of trying. Computer programming, you only learn by just doing it, trying it, getting all these errors. When I program, I still get a lot of errors. My whole life is one big error. At least that's what my parents, told me. They're still married almost 45 years, but They have one son that was successful in life, and they have one that ended up in America. So, but you know, my father is happy because he visits a few times a year, and the weather in the Netherlands is not that great, so now and then. So then they just visited around my birthday, yeah, and then the weather is so nice, yeah, and so that he likes that. So he's happy because of that. So, so that he defines that as success. And looking at my mom, I understand why. So you have to understand that not everything I say is true, okay? But that's one thing you need to understand. So computer programming, you do not learn by trying. Just don't try it all. No, that you really have to try. So here again, the week and the homeworks. And I believe the 27th of May is highlighted red because I believe it's like Memorial Day or something. That's one special day that we're supposed to memorize something. Yeah? So that's this one. So we still have to figure out, because in this week, there is a quiz planned. So the Monday session, because the 27th is on a Monday, we have to figure out what to do. Okay? But that will come along the way. We will figure it out. We had the same things last year. So here you see the date. So first the week, then the actual dates, then what we will cover in class, lecture. So 1 and 2. So this week we will cover chapter 1 and 2 in class. And then what you will do in lab that week. And then the homeworks that we expect you to do. And for each of those homeworks, so in this case you're supposed to do this week, the session this morning was supposed to do question 1 through 16, 18 through 20, 22 to 25, and so forth. And the answers are there, okay? We provide you with the answers. But again, the best way to do this is not to look at the answer and say, oh, I know how to do that, but try it yourself, then look at the answer. If you can successfully answer all of those homework questions, you will definitely get an A for this course. Okay, I'm just trying to give you some benchmarks, what makes you feel more comfortable. Okay. Now again, what I already said before, but I'll highlight it again, that students must attend the lab sessions for which they are enrolled. This is very important. And I understand that something can happen in your family. Your pet can die. Your cold fish can generate offspring. Can all kind of things can happen. Like happy events or sad events. And then please talk to me. First talk to the TAs. And they know that, then please come to me, okay? Because otherwise we have to make sure that we keep track of the attendance of each person, and then if people start switching, and also with exams and quizzes, things become really difficult to keep track of everything. So we really try to avoid that. I had one example, so I give you some suggestion how you want to be creative. Like 2 years ago, there was someone, and that person had a brother in jail. And each day that I administered a quiz or a test, he had a court hearing. Yeah? Each day. So each time I ended up checking all the paperwork, whether it was true or not, because they wanted to be there to support the brother, yeah? Because otherwise he was going to go back to the Netherlands. Now that's the last thing that you want, yeah? So anyway, so you can be creative with ideas, but we will check, okay? Now, all the exams and the quizzes are administered during lab sessions, okay? So the quiz only takes like half an hour. So then the rest of the lab session, you will still do the homeworks. Whereas the exam will take the entire lab session. We will not have a final, okay? The final will be exam number 3, which is not really a final because it counts for 20%, like exam number 2 and exam number 1. But this is administered the week prior to the finals. Okay? And that's just the way things are set up. So are there any questions so far? So please ask questions, okay? I tend to be generally approachable. So if you ask a question, no matter what, about your grandmother or so, ask. If so, okay, that's the question. And sometimes I can't see because there's this fantastic light. I'm getting a 10, but keep going. Yeah.
When is the group project due?
Yeah, so that is something that I tend to be flexible with. So I need to turn in the final grades the Thursday after the finals week, 5 p.m., okay? So what I've done in the past is I've said, you know, you can turn it in on Monday the latest, after the finals week. But then some people complain because they say, no, I'd rather have it earlier because I'm going on vacation that week and otherwise my group members, they're not going to finish, blah, blah, blah. But that's up to you. I don't mind. So I can tell you that's the reason I postpone it till Monday, so that during that finals week, you don't have to work on that team project and you have time available to do other things, yeah? That's why I typically do it on Monday. So whatever is most convenient, I don't have a set date. I like to help you guys that you can do the best possible job. Is that a reasonable answer or? Any other question?
Does quiz 1 cover chapters 1 through 2 or 1 through 4?
1 and 2. Yeah, so we will always cover the material that has been covered in class prior to the quiz. So the Monday session for next week, yeah, we'll do the quiz. And so what has been covered then is chapter 1 and 2. Whereas the Wednesday session next week, we'll still do the first quiz, but we also have on Monday, we will cover chapter 3. So are we still following? Okay. So then the Wednesday session already has some more information that doesn't really help with answering the questions on the quiz, but we started working on chapter 3. Now, let's now go to... So I had to make one slide. Yeah, so this is my cell phone. I've had students call me Saturday morning 4 a.m. I saw with the final team project, I've had students like Skyping me Friday evening, what is it, Saturday morning 2 a.m. Yeah, so they find your name on Skype, yeah, because I have such a strange name, yeah. Again, fantastic family, yeah. Fantastic name, so I think there's only one person with this name in the entire world. Honestly, you Google it and you just find FBI most wanted, yeah? but have a look. And so I had students that they start Skyping with me, and then it's like Saturday 2 a.m., the Monday before the deadline, yeah? They start asking questions, complete pieces of code are going over the Skype, yeah? And I'm supposed to jump in and say, yeah, you know, that's fantastic, well done, yeah? and then I go to sleep at 4 a.m. after answering, and I have a student calling at 8 a.m. And then you tell them, you like you know, yeah, I mean, 4 hours of sleep. And then they start complaining why you're actually sleeping at all, yeah? I don't know. Okay, MATLAB introduction, simple calculations. We'll start with something simple. And so this is a MATLAB script, believe it or not. And now you're looking at this, you're like, oh my God, what does this do? I have no idea. Now, when I saw this an hour ago, I thought the same thing. But by now I understand it more or less. So this is a MATLAB script. You go on the internet, and you can find thousands and thousands and thousands of MATLAB scripts, okay? You can find them and you can play with them. So let's see what this creates, okay? So I just copy paste this script this symbol, here you see, let's see here, that's what happened when your parents have been married for so long. So we do, I think I should do Control C here, so I select everything, yeah? Control C, and then I go to MATLAB here, I clear my memory, and we'll go over all this starting on Wednesday, okay? And now I just copy paste this entire thing in this script, okay? And look what it creates. This looks like a leaf of a marijuana or something. I don't know, but... No, this looks like a leaf. And imagine, you had to draw this by yourself, yeah? Each dot, yeah? That would take you a lot of time, yeah? Unless you're very gifted. But MATLAB can do this in just in this set of lines here. And again, I'm not going to ask you to do something like this. This is very highly specialized, or so, okay? But you can create that leaf with this script here, where you essentially have a number of variables, N, A, B, C, D, E, and F. And then you have what we call a for loop, which is done many times. And then there's some post-processing here. And then there's a plot statement, and then you get something like this. I found it was pretty interesting. Such a simple script that could create something like this. Yeah, probably a lunatic has created this that is really bored and thought like, what am I going to do with my time? But at the same time, I think it's pretty interesting. So this is what you can do with MATLAB, okay? And again, now you work with Excel. You're used to looking at data with Excel, probably, or some spreadsheet software. Yeah, you have a data X versus Y. And you like to fit a line through the data. Or you'd like to do something else, calculate the mean, the standard deviation. You can do all that in MATLAB 100 times faster. At the beginning I said 10 times faster, but it's now already 100 times faster. Because MATLAB is faster and faster, but no. MATLAB is just very convenient. So let's just open up MATLAB, okay? We have 15 minutes left for today. And chapter 2 of the book, okay? So chapter 2. So you can read chapter 1. I'm not going to ask really anything about chapter 1, but it's just some background material. And chapter 2 is called Interactive Computing with MATLAB. Okay, now let's see what we can do in MATLAB. I first of all, I clear my memory, and there's a state. So one thing you should also recognize and realize is that there's a lot of statements that you're going to learn. And when you ask the question, why is it that statement? That's just convention. That's just a decision that once has been made. So for instance, you see that I have all kind of stuff on my screen now, yeah? And maybe I like to have an empty screen again. Yeah? Because I don't like all this stuff here. Like, I want to start at the top again. Yeah, not here at the bottom. I'm right now here. And I don't like all these Rembrandt paintings on top of me, okay? So what you can do, for instance, clear screen. And it's like this. It's a statement CLC. And then MATLAB knows clear the screen. Okay? And why is that statement CLC? Because people at one point decided they were having a brainstorm session with vodka light, and the question was, what statement do we use to clear the screen? And then one person said, CLZ. And then the other people were like, wow, you're brilliant. And that's why this is a built-in, this is what they call a built-in function. Okay? And I can also see what's in the memory of MATLAB, because MATLAB, like a human, we have memory, yeah? Which is useful at times, and sometimes it's not useful. So I can see in MATLAB's memory if I type the statement whose, and then what I see, remember I copy-pasted that script with the leaf, and with which had A, B, C, D. Now you see all the variable names, the first column. Then you see their size. The size means essentially the number of elements they have. Then the number of bytes and a class which is called double, and you can forget about that for now. Okay? So if I now type A, this is how A looked when I introduced A. So A has four elements. A is what we call a horizontal vector. Or a row vector. People are looking at me like as if it's a matrix. So this is what we call a vector. Okay? A single number, like if I define h is 2, then h is called a scalar. That's a single number. That's called a scalar. But A has four elements, and they're horizontal, and we call A a row vector, or a horizontal vector. And the first element of A is 0. And I can ask for the third element of A. And what's the answer?
0.2.
Yeah, it's 0.2. So with round brackets and then the number, the index, I can ask for specific numbers of A. Now, so this is a horizontal vector, yeah, row vector. But maybe some people don't like row vectors. They're like, I only like column vectors. Now, MATLAB has a very simple comment to change it from a horizontal to a vertical vector. It's A prime. This accent over here, prime. And now A has become a column vector. And why is this symbol used? And why does it do exactly this? This is all convention. This is just what you have to learn. And it's really not so difficult, so don't be overwhelmed. In the beginning it might be, oh, what a lot of stuff. But no, there's just a few basic principles that come back all the time. Okay. Now I can also define a matrix in MATLAB, and I have a statement which is random. So now I define a variable t, and I indicate that my variable t is a matrix which is 5 by 5. So 5 by 5. This is number of rows, number of columns. Okay? And rand means random, which is a uniform random number between 0 and 1. So what I essentially have now is that I have 25 numbers between 0 and 1 in a matrix of 5 by 5. Because I specify, I want a matrix of 5 by 5 and I want those to be filled with random numbers. Now I can do this differently. I can do, for instance, 3 by 2. And now I have 3 rows, 2 columns. So this is number of rows, number of columns. And this is the name of the function that I'm looking for. I can also have another function. I could say, no, t is something else, is ones. And then they're all one. And again, we will start on Wednesday all over again with all this, but I'm just showing you a few things now. So, a variable with a single number is called a scalar. A variable with multiple numbers in a vector is called a vector. A variable that looks like a matrix with lines and columns is a matrix variable. Okay? So if I now look, what are the dimensions of t? If I do whose, and I look at t, what would be the size of t? Yes. If I look at t, 3 by 2. Now, and there's times, you know, that you've been working in MATLAB for a long time and you're just done. You're like, oh God. And then you just do the following. It's like ending a relationship. Clear all. And then whose, everything is gone. Okay? So statement clear all clears the entire memory. Statement CLC clears the screen, but maintains the memory. Clear all clears the entire memory. Not the screen though, because you still see all that stuff. Now, let's define now that I have a new variable. I start all over again on top. I say A is 4 and B is 6. And now I define C is A minus B. What is the answer? How much? Minus 2. Yeah, so that's how MATLAB works. So your calculator works the same way. But you don't say A is 4, B is 6. You directly type in 4 minus 6. And you get your answer. But the computer program works with variables. So A is a variable and B is a variable. And here we subtract B from A. And that gives us a new variable, C. And C is now a scalar, which is minus 2. I can also define another variable and I can add them together, addition. And it gives me 10. Because 4 plus 6 is 10. But now the trick here, okay? Imagine that I have R is ones, 3, we do 2 and 5. Oh, R. That happens all the time. Yeah, here. And then I define another that B is 2 times ones. Yeah? Does this make sense? So I define a variable R here, which has 2 rows, 5 columns. 2 rows, 5 columns, yeah? You see that here? 2 rows, 5 columns. That's just convention again. First the number of rows, then the number of columns. And I want that to be filled with values of 1. So that's what I'm going to get. And now what I describe here is that I define another variable B, which is also once 2 by 5, but I multiply that with 2. So I multiply each cell, which was a 1, with a scalar of 2. And that gives me now 2. And now the nice thing of MATLAB is that I can simply do that I can define a new variable W is R. I can just add them together. So MATLAB can add up complete matrices together and vectors. Whereas with your Excel worksheet or whatever, or your calculator, you need to do cell by cell. MATLAB immediately does each cell. But this only works if both these matrices are of the same size. Okay, for instance, one more column than R. And if I now say, you know what, let's add them together, what happens? Error using plus, matrix dimensions must agree because B does not have the same dimensions as R. So you cannot add them together. Okay? So you can only add factors and matrices together, divide them or whatever, if they are of the same dimension. This is rule number one in MATLAB. Before we leave, I'd like to show you one final thing. Now I have my B. Imagine that you'd like to compute the sinus of B, yeah? Now you can do that. You can assign a new variable and then you directly have the sinus of each element of B. And because sinus, sin, is a built-in function. Okay, and MATLAB has thousands and thousands and thousands of those built-in functions that you can use. And this is way faster than what you've probably used before. So Wednesday we will start all over again. Wednesday and Friday will chapter 1 and 2. Monday and Wednesday and Friday next week there's a quiz during the lab exam. If you have any questions, please contact the TAs.